Okay, so I have started the recording. I hope you guys all had a fine weekend. If you people have any questions so far about what we have studied, when will you post pre-final marks on CMS? Pre-finals will be posted this week or by Monday. Because I still have to check some things. Will be posted this week or by Monday.
अरे ये मार्क्स कब अपलोड करेंगे आप?
This week or by Monday.
सर इतना अरसा हो गया है.
Yes, I know. Any other question?
सर ये फाइनल पेपर्स का पैटर्न कैसे होगा? जस्ट लाइक मिड्स?
We are not sure because final, apparently the mail that we have received so far is finals are going to be physical and it will be like a limited time slot. So it might be, we'll have to wait until the end of this week to see if there's any update. But if it is like things are as they have announced, then most probably you guys will get paper-based exam. Perhaps you'll be giving some code, you'll have to write the output of that code, or you will be asked to write some code on paper or something like that. Okay, so but nothing is confirmed yet. As I said, we wait till the end of this week to see if there is any change in policy. Any topics left to study in this course? Yeah, topics are like, there are a lot of topics that are left. So we'll just see what we can study this week. And next week we'll reserve it for revisions, okay? Writing outputs is doable unlike the mid. I do not understand this comment. Okay, so any questions if you have got about the topics that we have already studied? No questions? Okay, so let me share my screen with you guys. Can you guys see this terminal? Can you guys see this terminal? Okay, good. So if you can see this terminal, then let us start with a program. Let's say, what have we got? We have this. Recursion. Okay, let's start with recursion. Recursion 3 NoCPP. It already exists, so let us delete this file. Open a mod. Okay. So this is like a file that we have studied in the last class, in which we had implemented a function called Fibonacci. Okay. So now this Fibonacci, okay, let me rename this file. Okay, this Fibonacci function, what will happen if I move this Fibonacci function from the implementation of the Fibonacci function from before the start of main to after मेन ओके सो वी हैव दिस फाइल इन विच इन मेन वी आर कॉलिंग दिस फिबोनाची फंक्शन एंड दिस फंक्शन इज डिफाइंड आफ्टर द फंक्शन मेन आफ्टर इट इज बीइंग कॉल्ड व्हाट विल हैपन व्हेन आई कंपाइल एंड रन दिस प्रोग्राम Anybody, can you guys hear me? Hello. Fib int n is not defined in that scope. Okay. You are saying this will be a message by the compiler, right? Okay. So what do you think? Will this be a warning or will this be an error? Okay, anybody else? Warning, anybody else? Okay, so by the way, what is this word that you have used in this scope? What is this scope that we are talking about? Leave it for later. For the moment, I'll ask another question. Is the function Fibonacci defined in this file or not? Defined, okay. So when you guys say that it will give us an output that the function is not defined in this scope, but it is defined, right? Okay, so you are saying that it is defined after the call. Good, good. Okay, so the next question is, do we have to define the function before the call? Okay, so we don't have to define a function before a only a declaration is necessary. Very good. Okay, so only a declaration is necessary before the call. Okay, and declaration, as Mohammed Farid pointed out, consists of the function prototype. Okay, so what is a function prototype or what is a function declaration? What does it consist of? Okay, so the function declaration or prototype consists of the return type, the name of the function, and any arguments that that function takes. Okay, the types of the arguments. Okay, even the names of the arguments are not necessary. Right, in declaration, we need only tell it the number of arguments and the type of each argument. Okay, good, very good. Okay, so let us see, run this program and see what happens. So here it is. I save it and then I run G++. Okay. Fib was not declared in this scope. Okay. So ओके, इट इज एन एरर. अच्छा, बाय द वे, इन सी प्लस, इन सी इट्स अ वार्निंग, इफ यू, बट सिंस वी आर यूजिंग सी प्लस प्लस, इट्स ए एन एरर. दैट्स लाइक अ डिस्कवरी फॉर मी ऑल्सो. ओके, सो वेरी गुड, हूएवर सेड दैट इट वुड बी एन एरर टेलिंग अस दैट फिब वाज नॉट डिक्लेयर्ड इन दिस स्कोप. सो नाउ ऑल दिस, आई मीन दिस एरर इज बिकॉज एज यू गैस वॉन्टेड आउट, द फंक्शन हैज बीन डिफाइंड आफ्टर द कॉल. ओके, and when the compiler reaches the function call, it does not know what is fib, okay, because it has not, it starts from the beginning of the file and it has not encountered anything from the beginning of the file till the call to fib. It has not encountered anything which is called fib. Okay, so when you tell it to call fib, it's like, what is fib? Okay, so that's why it gives you an error that it does not recognize fib. And it tells you that, sorry, fib was not declared in this scope. Very good. Although fib has been defined in this file, but it has been defined after the call to fib, okay, after main. So again, as you guys pointed out, it is not necessary to define everything before main. We can define functions after main, but we have to declare them before we call them. So a declaration, as you guys I hope remember from our starting lectures, is some statement that introduces a new thing to the program. Okay, so here in this case we want to introduce the function fib to our program before using it, so we will declare the function fib. Okay, and declaration, again you guys rightly pointed out, consists only of the prototype of the function, which is like return type, the name, the number and types of arguments. Okay, so we'll go here, we'll basically declare this function after, I mean before main, before it is called, and we will, so declaration can have the name of the arguments or it can not. Okay, so here we have chosen not to give the name of the arguments. You only give need to give the number of arguments and the type of each argument. So here we are saying our function fib takes only one argument of type integer. Okay, and its return type is also of type integer. Okay. Very good. So here you go, and now we have like defined the function fib after main, but we have declared it before using it, before the function call. We have declared it, we have introduced the function fib to our program on line number 10. Okay, so therefore when the compiler starts from the beginning of the file and it arrives at line number 14, it sees fib on line number 15 being called. By this time it has already encountered line number 10 and it knows that fib is a function, okay, and it takes only one argument of type integer. Okay, so therefore hopefully now it will not give us this error. Okay, you see, it has compiled and no error, because when it reached fib, it basically already knew what a fib is. So call to fib did not bother our compiler. It continued checking our program and later it found the definition of fib also. So everything was fine and our compiler basically compiled our program without any warnings or errors. So this is it basically, ke function definitions, we can have them anywhere, but we have to have the declaration in our file before we use that function or call that function. Okay, is this thing clear? Any question so far? Okay, if my voice is not correct, then let me plug this network cable just to make sure that. Everything is good from our end. Okay, so now I'm connected to this wired networks. I hope इट्स बेटर नाउ. थैंक यू उस्मान फॉर अनसोलिसिटेड कॉमेंट. साले इज इट एनी बेटर?
Yes, sir, it's better now.
Okay, good. So, any questions so far? Have you guys understood what I have said so far?
Sir, while you were explaining, your voice was gone from, like, I can't hear anything that you explained. So, can you explain it again?
Okay, so I'll be quick because I think you, at least you saw what was on the screen. So, function definition was when we declared, defined this function after main, and we, like, tried to compile our program without any declaration before the function call, it gave us an error. Was that clear until then, Saleh?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So the problem was that when our compiler starts checking this program from the beginning of the file and it arrives inside main and it sees that there has been a call to fib, okay? Since it has not encountered anything called fib until that time, it gives us an error. Okay, it gives it tells you that what is fib. It says fib is nothing that has been defined so far, so I don't know what fib is. Okay, so it says fib is not declared in this scope, defined in this scope. Okay? That's because although fib is defined in this file, but it's defined after the function call. Okay, and the compiler has not yet had the chance to see the definition of the fib. For this, if we want the flexibility that we can define our functions anywhere, in that case, we should at least have the declaration of the function before we use that function. Okay, before a call to any function, at least there should be a declaration introducing that function to our program. Okay, it might not, the declaration usually does not have the body of the function. The compiler does not need the body of the function at that time, but it needs at least that there is something called fib. Okay, what is it? What's its type? Is it a function? Is it a variable? And if it's a function, what's its return type? And how many arguments it takes and of which type? Okay, so declaration of a function basically introduces the function to the program and it consists of the return type of the function, the name of the function, the number of arguments, and the types of each argument for that function. Okay, so that's what we did here on line number 10. Let me put line number 10. We declared or introduced the function fib to our program. Okay, so here is the declaration. It consists only of the return type, the name, the number and type of arguments. Here it's only one argument of type int and semicolon. Okay? There's no body in the declaration of the function. So now if we compile, and as we compile this function, our compiler did not give us any error because when it arrived on line number 14 and it saw this call to fib, by line number 14 it has already encountered the declaration of fib on line number 10, so it knows that fib is a function which takes one argument of type int. Okay, so now it does not complain on line number 14 that fib is something it does not know. Okay, so that's what I was trying to say here, that to use any function, we have to first declare it before calling it. Okay? Previously, we had the definition before main. Okay? At that time, the definition was working both as a declaration as well as a definition. Okay? But now, since we have moved the definition of the function after main, we should at least have the declaration before main. Okay, so that the program knows by the time it arrives line number 14, it knows that what is fib. Okay, so this implementation, we saw that it compiled without any problems or without any errors or warnings. Is it clear? Is the voice still problematic? Yes, sir, means is it clear? Is it प्रॉब्लमेटिक, इट्स फ्लक्चुएटिंग. ओके ओके सो
सर इट इज जीए के इंटरनेट.
Maybe because I have attached this cable, so there's not like much more that we can do. So I'm afraid you'll have to bear with this quality. Okay, so any questions so far about the declaration, definition, how to declare or define a function? Okay, since there are no questions, then I'll assume that everything is clear. And now let me move to the next thing that I wanted to ask you. What is this line number one? What is hash include iostream? What is it doing, this? What is this line doing in our program? Line number one. It's a preprocessor directive. Very good. And what is it doing? Getting access to library iostream. Okay. Good. That's very, very close. Anybody else? Does anybody here does not know what a preprocessor is? Okay, anybody else? Okay, so what is the compilation flow of our whole compilation, starting from the CPP file and until we get the binary executable? Okay, remember we at some point we discussed in our class that the CPP file that you guys type in, it's called the source code of the program. Okay, so there's a whole process through which this source code, it is transformed, and ultimately at the end you get an executable file, okay, which is in binary. So source file is in text, and the last final output that we get is the executable file, which is in binary. Okay. So what are the different steps involved in this process, from the source code until it is transformed into the binary executable? Basically, this source code serves as an input for different softwares, which stepwise transforms this code until it becomes the binary executable. Read or write the input output stream. I'm afraid, Usmanta, this comment is not very related to what we are talking about. Source code to preprocessor to compiler. Good. So source code is given to the preprocessor. Again, a preprocessor is a software which will basically go through this source code, and wherever it sees these commands starting with hash symbol, which are like preprocessor directives, it will implement those directives. Okay, directive mean here directive means command. Okay, so anything starting with hash is a preprocessor directive, or it is a command to the preprocessor. Okay, so what the preprocessor will do, it will act on all these commands. Okay, we'll see what this command hash include does. Okay. So hash include iostream basically is a command to the preprocessor to go and include the iostream code in this program. Okay. So okay, so .cpp file is converted into given to the preprocessor, which will implement or act upon the preprocessor directives which are present in this code. And again, it will output a transformed version, which will also be in text form. Okay, it will also be the C code. C code, C++ code. It will be CPP file. It will be in text form and it will contain C++ code. So that is your initial CPP file passed through the preprocessor. Still remains a CPP file containing C++ code. But the preprocessor has implemented all the commands that were given to the preprocessor. Now the output of the preprocessor, the C++ code generated by the preprocessor, will be given to the compiler. Okay. And then the compiler will basically check the syntax, check all the errors, etc., and convert your C++ code into binary, into assembly code. Okay. So that assembly code is very different from what you have written in C++. Okay. The meaning will be the same on both codes, because the assembly code is like a translation of your C++ code, but assembly syntax is much different than C++ syntax. Okay. So to recapitulate, we started with a CPP file containing C++ code in text. It went to a preprocessor who implemented all the commands, starting with hash, and it gave us the, again, CPP file containing C++ code in text form still. Okay. That output of the preprocessor is given to the compiler, which converts our C++ code into assembly code. Okay. Assembly code is still in text form. Okay. So that assembly code now is given to the assembler. Now that assembler will convert this assembly code into binary code, which we call the object code. Okay, so the assembly file or file containing assembly code will be converted into a binary file, which we call an object file. So when you have all those object files, you can have many object files in your program. Okay, so all those object files are given to the linker. So the linker basically will combine all these object files that you have written plus any library that you are using. So it will link all these object files and the library code together to form one file, which we will call the executable file. Okay, and that executable file will be in binary form. Okay, is it clear, the whole process from C++ code CPP file to the executable binary file? Our code basically passes through, in C++ at least, it passes through the preprocessor, the compiler, the assembler, and the linker. Okay. After all these steps, we will get one final executable binary file, which we can run. Can you repeat after the compiler? So the compiler will basically convert our code to assembly language. And that assembly language code is then passed to another software, which we call the assembler. Okay. So the assembler will take that assembly code and it will convert that assembly code to binary code and will put it in a file which we call an object file. Okay. So you can have multiple CPP files in your program, and all those multiple CPP files, they will be converted into ultimately object files. There will be one object file for every CPP file. Okay, so the assembler will convert your code from assembly to object code or binary code and put it in object file. Okay. So the linker comes in after that. Once your code has been converted to object files, all these object files plus any library that you are using, they will be passed to the linker. So the linker will basically link all these object files together along with any library code that you have used, and by linking them, it will combine them in one single binary file, which we call the executable file. Okay, and it's basically that executable file that you are running in the end. Okay, linker is the very last step in this whole process. Is it clear? ओके सो इफ यू गाइस हैव अंडरस्टूड दिस देन लेट मी एज आई जस्ट सेड यू कैन बेसिकली डिवाइड योर कोड इनटू मल्टीपल सीपीपी फाइल्स हियर वी हैव ओनली वन सीपीपी फाइल लेट मी शो यू हियर here there is only one file that we have been using so far it's called multi_01.cpp right so this is our file which contains our whole program now for small programs like this one for example programs are very small so we can keep them all in our in one cpp file but usually as you will progress in your degree and later in your jobs you will write bigger programs okay now bigger programs they can I mean right now your programs will start going to hundreds or thousands of lines and then even hundreds of thousands or millions of lines of programs they exist in the world in that case it is very practical to have all your code in one cpp file you can have it there's nothing stopping you but it is considered good common sense or best practice to divide your code into multiple files and code which is related to each other it should be put in one file and code which is like different from each other it they should be put in different files okay so your program can consist of multiple cpp files is this understandable what I'm saying that for like good maintenance of code when your code becomes bigger it is better to divide it into different modules and or in different files you divide your code in different files and you put code that is related to each other in one file and codes that are different from each other you put them in different files okay and then later you can compile all these files together to make one executable file Do these separate CPU files have to be saved in the same folder? No, not at all. You can even have subdirectories, subfolders containing similar CPU files together. And later, when you compile them, you have to give the compiler the correct path to each file. Okay. As long as you are giving the compiler the correct path of each file, you do not need to have all these CPU files in the same folder. Okay to others is it clear okay you guys are not answering so I will continue ahead and give you an example maybe it will be more clear so here we have this file called multi1.cpp so let me open it and let us divide our code into two files so let us divide this main function will keep in this file and this function fib we take it to another file okay so let's call this new file multi_cpp and we paste it here Okay. So now I have two files. Here you guys can see them. Where are they? Yeah. Multi1.cpp and multi2.cpp. Okay. So if I show you the contents of this file, multi1.cpp is this. It contains only main. Okay. And multi2.cpp. It contains only this function fib okay so fib we have defined in a separate file and main we have defined in a separate file so let us compile this file together so g++ multi1.cpp multi2.cpp okay so now I'm telling it my compiler to compile these two files together. Okay, before I compile these two files together, let me just compile one file to tell you what does it say. Okay, it says undefined reference to fib. Okay, because it cannot find fib in this file. Okay, if you see this multi-cpp, the compiler starts at the top. It basically does everything, and it sees fib is a function, good. It sees fib is being called, very good. Okay, so here it has like finished this file. So the compiler will create an object file out of this. This error that you are seeing here, undefined reference to fib. Let me call it again. This error here, it is not coming from the compiler. Okay, it is coming from the linker. You see here it says LD returned one. LD is a name of the linker for G++. Okay, so the linker is saying, the linker, you know, it gets to combine all these files, object files, and it makes sure that any function that has been called in any of the file, there exists a definition for that function. Okay, otherwise it will not know what code to execute for that function. Okay, so the linker basically sees that fib function is being called, but there is no body for fib. Fib has been defined nowhere in this file. Okay, so the linker says that undefined reference to fib, all these four calls to fib, that it does not, or it was unable to find the body for the function fib. Okay, so now let us tell it that it should also compile this second file, and now normally it should be able to find the body of the function fib. You see, now it compiled without any problem. Okay, so now if I run this function, it basically gave me this output. Okay, so when I compile this, these two files, the compiler compiled them separately. So the compiler compiled them separately, and it basically generated two object files. The assembler generated two object files, and ultimately the linker combined these two object files and along with the library code to generate one executable, which we ran. Okay, is this thing clear? That you can divide your C++ code into multiple files? Okay, that's a very good question. How can we compile multiple files in dev C++ IDE? Okay. So on here, I gave it to the compiler that you should compile this file. Okay. Now in Dev C++, you guys have a Visual IDE, and you create a project in that Dev C++. Okay, and on the left side, you usually have a menu which is telling you which files are included in your project. Okay. Am I correct? Like, I have not used Dev C++ for a long time, so you guys correct me if I say anything stupid. But on the left, usually you will be seeing a list of files telling you which files are included in your project. Okay, so when you compile this program, the compiler in the background automatically will compile all the files that are in your project. Okay, by default, it will compile all the files in your project. Okay. So if you want to divide your code in multiple files, then you have to add all those files to your project. Okay, so this can be done in two ways. Either you can add a new file to your project, so you go to project, add file to project, etc., and it will add a blank file to your project, and then you can write code in that file. or let's say you already have a file containing code. The file is already in that code. Oh, sorry, the code is already in that file. You have a file containing all the code and you want to add that file to the project. So that is also possible. You can basically add an existing file to your project. Once those extra files have been added to your project, then you just compile and it will compile all the files. Okay, by default, it compiles all the files that are present in your project. Did you guys get it? In Dev C++, to compile multiple files, you need to basically add those extra files to your project. You can either create new files within the project or add existing files to your project. By default, when you create a project, it creates one file for you. Okay, in that case, you will, you write your code in that single file. Okay, but you are not limited to that single file. You can have as many files in your code in your project as you want, but you need to add those extra files to the project so that the compiler notices them and compiles them together. What is this file called? No, file handling is something different. File handling is basically reading and writing two files. We are not through your program. We are not reading and writing two files through your program. We'll see file handling sometime later. This is like dividing your project into multiple files. The process of creating separate files differs depending on the ID. There might be slight variation, but it's the same process. You add files to your project. Okay. So the option, when you right click on the project, the option that you are presented like add file or add new file or add existing file, the wording might be slightly different, but it is basically the same process. Okay. It's such a basic process that all IDEs do it the same way, almost the same way, I think. Why is this even needed? When you have a very big program, when you have a program consisting of hundreds of thousands of lines, it is impractical to have all your code in one file. Okay, just scrolling in a 100,000 line file will like bring tears to your eyes. Okay, so it is very practical in such scenarios when you have a very big code to divide your code into multiple files. Okay, so the idea is that code that is related to each other should be in one file, and codes that are different or doing different things, they should be put in different files. Okay, so this is a logical division in your program that you create by dividing your code into different files. It has multiple advantages. First of all, it basically makes maintaining your code easy. Okay. Second, when you have a problem or bug, the compiler will tell you in which file you have a problem. Okay, so you focus only on that file. Okay, let's say you have 100,000 lines code, which you have divided into 100 files containing 1,000 lines. Okay. So when the compiler tells you in which file you have a problem, then you go and focus only on that file. Okay, so the scope of your debugging has now become much, much narrower, and it's much easier to debug or to go look in a file containing 1,000 lines than a file which contains 100,000 lines. Okay, so it's for our own ease or our own to facilitate ourselves that we divide our code into logically different segments and we put similar code in one file. Is it clear the reason behind this? Otherwise, it would be very, very complicated to scroll files containing hundreds of thousands of lines. And also you protect yourself against mistakes. Let's say when you are scrolling a 100,000 line file, if by mistake you delete something, you could delete the whole program. Okay? While if you are in a smaller file and by mistake you delete something, you will be damaging very small part of your program. Okay, so it's to protect us against our own stupidities also. Is it clear? Okay, so if this is clear, then there's one more thing that you guys should know. Yes, that is why I'm giving you this lecture, that you submit your code in different files. Okay, so one more thing. Let us say, so usually our when we divide our code into different files, we have two types of files in C++. Can you guys tell me what are the two types of files? One is called the CPP files. There are .cpp files in our code. Oops, .cpp. And what are the other types of files that we have in our code or in our programs? No, .exe file is at the end, the source code. The source code is divided into two types of files in C++. One is .cpp files, the other is .h files. Very good. Okay. So what's the difference between .cpp files and .h files? What do we have in .cpp files? And what kind of content do we put in .h files when we divide our source code? Okay, so if you guys don't know or are not responding, then I'll tell you that .cpp file usually contains, very good, codes, or we call them definitions. Okay. So .cpp files contain definitions and .h files contain declaration. Okay, so .cpp file contains implementation. We'll later see there are different kinds of .cpp file contains definitions, or the implementation also we can call them, and .h file contains declarations. So right now we have only seen declaration definitions for functions. Later we'll see declaration and definitions for many other things. So just keep in mind that .cpp file contains definition and .h file contains declaration. So here in our example, we have put this fib definition for the function fib in multi 2.cpp. Okay. So the declaration definition is multi 2.cpp, definition is still in main. Okay, what we can do is we can also basically take this declaration and put it somewhere else, let's say multi, let's go 02.h. Okay, so here it's like function declaration. We have put it in a separate file called multi underscore 2.h. So what will happen if I compile this program? Okay, let me remember, we compiled this program using this command. So right now I'll again use this command to error. It is saying in multi 1.cpp in function main, fib was not declared in this scope. It's the same error that we saw at the beginning of this class. So tell me again, why is this problem occurring? Why is this compiler giving us this error? Okay, we'll come to this, but tell me for the benefit of other people, what is the problem? Why is this problem happening? Because in multi1.cpp, in the function main, we are using the function fib without having it declared before main. Is it clear? Let me open the multi1.cpp. Multi1.cpp on line 12, it says fib is not declared. Okay, we are using fib here. We are calling fib, but fib has not been declared before its function call. Is it clear the error? Why is it happening? Okay, good. So we need to declare this function here. Okay, but the declaration is in the header file multi2.h. So multi2.h, but if you want to keep it separate, we can just import that code here in this file by using this preprocessor directive, which we call include. Okay. So as Mohammad Rafi pointed out, we can basically have in our code, we can go here and we can basically add a directive here to the preprocessor to include, or not IOStream, it's called multi2. Okay, so I'm using double quotes instead of these angular brackets, less than greater than, and we'll see later why. But it's basically the same thing. They include on line number 1 and on line number 3, they are basically doing the same thing. Include, what it does is, it's a preprocessor directive. When you tell it to hash include something, it will, the preprocessor will go ahead, take that something and just paste its code here in this line. Okay, it's just copy paste. It will go ahead, include something, it will go to that something and copy it and paste it here instead of this line. Okay, it's only that. So since this line contains the declaration, so that declaration will be pasted here instead of line number 3. Okay, and this will basically solve our problem, that since the declaration will be pasted here, so that when the compiler receives this code, compiler will see that declaration and it will basically pose no problem. So let me with this compile it again, and you will see that this time it has gone without any hitch and it runs also. Okay, so let me open the file again for you. So here it is. You can divide our program into different files. Usually we divide it into two types of files, .cpp files and .h files. .cpp file contains different definitions and .h file contains different declaration. So this way, .h file, we can include them using this preprocessor directive hash include anywhere we feel their need. Okay, is it clear? Yes, you want to say something, Uzair?
Yes, sir. I have a question about this multi2.h. Where is this file multi2.h? From where it take the code of multi2.h? And paste it over here.
Okay, let me basically show you in this here. So here between the on line number, let's see, where is line number? Here in between line number 1 and line number 3 in include, between the angle brackets or between the quotes, we will give the full path of the file that you want to include. Okay, if we don't give any path here, like between the quotes, as I said here in multi2.h, it will try to find it in the current directory, okay, in the current folder in which we are right now, in which there is this file multi1.cpp. Okay, so let me show you this current file here, current directory here. So here in the current directory that we are in, we have this multi1.cpp which contains our main, and in which we have called that include. Okay, so it will be the current directory of this file multi1.cpp, and then we have multi2.cpp, and then we have multi2.h. okay, so if you don't give any path, it will try to find it in the current directory. Okay, is it clear?
Sir, if this file is not present in the current directory, so then where will it go and look up for that file? For example, if we need that file from other sources, so what will the program do in that case?
Then it is your job, it is your duty to tell the program where to find it. For example, let's say if let's say if this file was in my C/documents, okay, and not in the current directory, so I will give it this path here, that C, I don't know, in Windows it's / or forward slash, but documents / multi2.h. okay, so then it is my job or the programmer's job or your job to tell the program where to go and find that file.
Thank you, sir.
Okay, any other question? Thank you, Usman Tahir, for this totally unrelated update to this lecture. Okay, so we'll basically continue this lecture tomorrow. Try this, and if you have any questions, bring them tomorrow to the class. Usman Tahir, you wanted to talk about something? Before, let me ask this question, answer this question. .h file contains the working of the function. No. The working of the function is the definition of the function. Definitions are always contained in CPP files. Okay? So the working of the function will be in .cpp file. .h file contains declarations. Declaration is only in the case of a function, the prototype. Okay, so .h file contains only the function signature or the function prototype. Is it clear? Okay, we'll see if you reverse this, the contents, then problems may arise. We'll see in next classes. Class, don't talk about classes right now. You will have more than enough classes next semester. Anything else? Okay, so if anybody has any other question, comment, they can do. Otherwise, questions of assignment three, let's talk about it tomorrow. Okay, people here are more impatient than you, and they've already started taking the attendance. So let's talk about it tomorrow. And okay, so mark your attendance here. Are there other files under C file? No, Mohammed Fareh, in C++ source code, in the source code, usually it's only .cpp files and .h files. Okay, so you guys can take up these questions tomorrow also. We are not finished with this topic yet. So okay, so if there are no more questions, then I'll stop this recording.